गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट अ चैप्टर इन हिस्ट्री। इस सेकंड चैप्टर दैट इज न्यू किंग्स एंड किंगडम्स। इन दिस चैप्टर वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी द न्यू किंग्स, न्यू रूलर्स इमर्ज्ड इन द इंडिया। ओके, सो बाय द 17th सेंचुरी मेनी न्यू लैंडलॉर्ड्स एंड वॉरियर्स चिफ्टन्स इमर्ज इन द सब कॉन्टिनेंट। इट्स टॉकिंग अबाउट इंडिया एट द टाइम। इन द एंशियंट टाइम द नेबरिंग कंट्रीज लाइक पाकिस्तान, अफगानिस्तान, नेपाल, भूटान, बांग्लादेश ऑल वर पार्ट ऑफ इंडिया ओनली, सो इट वॉज कॉल्ड एज सब कॉन्टिनेंट। डियर स्टूडेंट्स, एवरी वन शुड नो और शुड बी अवेयर कि वॉट इज सब कॉन्टिनेंट। द एग्जिस्टिंग किंग्स रिकग्नाइज दैम एज देयर सामंतास और सबॉर्डिनेट्स। ग्रेजुअली द वेल्थ एंड इन्फ्लुएंस ऑफ द सामंतास इंक्रीज ड्यू टू विच दे बिकेम महासामंतास और महामंडलेश्वरा। दे स्टार्टेड रूलिंग ओवर इंडिपेंडेंट किंगडम्स। यस, स्लोली देयर वेल्थ इंक्रीज्ड। नाउ दे बिकेम इंडिपेंडेंट एंड स्टार्टेड रूलिंग इंडिपेंडेंट किंगडम्स। एंड वन सच किंगडम वॉज राष्ट्रकूटास, हु रोज टू प्रोमिनेंस इन द 18th सेंचुरी अंडर तांती दुर्गा। सो हु रोज टू प्रोमिनेंस मीन्स एट द इम्पोर्टेंस, and Tanti Durga was the ruler, though subordinate to the Chalukyas of Karnataka. Tanti Durga declared himself a Kshatriya after performing a ritual called Hiranyagarbha. Hiranyagarbha is a ritual which was performed because it is a ritual in which any person who is not Kshatriya and want to become a Kshatriya can become. It was considered as a rebirth. The individual who want to become a Kshatriya, who want to become a warrior for his kingdom, then he has to perform a Hiranyagarbha ritual. It was considered as a rebirth of the sacrificer as a Kshatriya, even though he is not by birth. Means anyone who is not by birth Kshatriya but want to become a Kshatriya or a warrior, then by the Hiranyagarbha ritual he can be perform this and become the Kshatriya. It was also called as the golden worm. Okay. On other hand, there were enterprising people who used their skills to carve out independent kingdoms. Gurjara Pratihara ruled over the areas of Gujarat and Rajasthan. Gurjara Pratiharas, as these Rashtrakutas were there, same way in some parts of Gujarat, there were Gurjara Pratiharas, the rulers ruling over the parts of Gujarat and Rajasthan. Though Brahmanas, they gave up their traditional position to establish the independent kingdom in Karnataka and Rajasthan respectively. Yes, so Brahmanas who were given the full importance at this period, they gave up their traditional position to establish independent kingdoms in Karnataka and Rajasthan. Many of the new kings adopted titles which made them feel very powerful and superior. Some of them were Maharaja Dhiraj, meaning the great king. Yes, many of them kings, they were given the titles of Maharaja Dhiraj, means king of kings, great king, overlord of kings, Tribhuvana Chakravarti, meaning lord of the three world. So such titles were given and they feel, by this they feel very powerful and superior. Okay, so this was about the how the kings, new kings and kingdoms developed. Now we are going to study about the resources. Which resources were produced and how they were able to get during this period. The resources were usually obtained from what they produced. Then they used these resources to establish the king financially and for the construction of temple and forts. Therefore, these resources were important. Yes, resources were very important during this period because they got this from what they produced, what they have carved, and they used the resources to establish king financially and for construction of temple and forts. Yes, either it was used in the army or it was used for the construction of temples and the forts. The prashastis or inscriptions composed by Brahmanas. So students, prashasti is the appreciation letter, and this was composed by Brahmans. Because at that time Brahmins only knew the Sanskrit language. Clear? So prashastis were the appreciation letter. Though not necessarily accurate, give us idea how rulers wanted to project themselves. King rewarded Brahmanas by land grants recorded on the copper plates. And for this appreciative letter of prashastis, Brahmanas, they were awarded by land grants, zameen, land was given to them, and with a recorded on the copper plates, it was engraved. Okay, as the they appreciated the rulers or the kings on the copper plates, minarets, pillars everywhere, forts. Same way, the kings also gave them grants, which was engraved on the copper plates. See, and what these prashastis contain? Prashastis contain about the administrative system, about the hobbies of the king, how he ruled, how he made his people happy. Everything was engraved on copper plates, rocks, pillars, cave walls, to emphasize more and more about the ruler. Now, warfare for the wealth. For centuries, the dynasties like Gujarat Pratiharas, Rashtrakutas and Pala fought for the control over the Kannauj region. Its location on the banks of Ganga in Uttar Pradesh mean that anyone who controlled Kannauj would be the master of Gangetic Valley. Yes. See, Kannauj was at the bank of river Ganga. Presently we can talk in the Uttar Pradesh. So it was that, okay, who is controlling that Kannauj can be the master of complete Gangetic Valley, because the all the area surrounded by this river Ganga. And since this long drawn conflict involved three parties, it is termed as three-party struggles. Yes. And the three rulers, the Gujarat Pratihara, Rashtrakutas and Palas, they fought firm among themselves to control the Kannauj. So it was called as three-party struggle. Dear students, three-party struggles means three rulers, Gujarat Pratiharas, Rashtrakutas and Palas, they fought over the control of Kannauj. So it was called as the three-party struggle because three rulers, three states or three kingdoms were fighting to control over the Kannauj. Consequently, the construction of temples was an important way by which rulers tried to demonstrate their powers and authority. Yes. At the same time, construction of temples was an important part by which the rulers can say that they had the power and authority. Consequently, temples, a storehouse of wealth, became the main target of foreign invasion. Now, as the rulers were getting constructed temples and their wealth and treasures were also being kept in this, they were not kept, but these temples were the storehouse of wealth, and so they became a main target of foreign invasions. By the end of the 10th century, the Turkish general had proclaimed their control over many territories, and one of the most outstanding Turkish ruler was Mahmud of Ghazni. Students, you might have heard the word Mahmud of Ghazni. He was of Turkish and he ruled from 997 to 1030 and invaded India around 17 times. And this Mahmud Ghazni, he invaded India for 17 times, not for ruling, but for he was attracted by the wealth of India. And you know, in the ancient time, India was called as the Sone ki Chidiya, golden sparrow. So he was much attracted by the gold and wealth of India. So he attracted 17 times to plunder the wealth of India. And he looted North Indian temples, including the Somnath temple in Gujarat. So he made 17 attacks on the Somnath temple, Lord Shiva's temple, and looted, plundered the wealth of that Somnath temple. He used the wealth to create a splendid city at Ghazni, and all the wealth he looted was used in the construction of his city Ghazni. Clear? So this Mahmud of Ghazni, a Turkish ruler, attacked India 17 times to attack the Somnath temple and looted the wealth. And this wealth he used for the construction of his city Ghazni. He entrusted a scholar called Al-Biruni to write an account of the subcontinent. And he had a scholar named Al-Biruni. Yes, and Al-Biruni, he asked him to write about the subcontinent, how he came to India, plundered the wealth, everything. His book is known as Kitab ul Hind. So Al-Biruni's book Kitab ul Hind, which is written in Arabic and still important source of information for the historians. Yes, and it is the storehouse about the Indian information. So students, you can underline this Kitab ul Hind, a book written by Al-Biruni to describing about the India's ancient India. Now, Chauhanas were also known as Shamanas. They ruled over the region of Delhi and Ajmer. So we can say the Delhi and some parts of Rajasthan, Chauhanas. As you might have heard the Prithviraj Chauhan, the word. Same way, they were also known as Shamanas. Their attempt to expand their territory in the west and the east was opposed by Chalukyas of Gujarat and Gahavadhawalis of western Uttar Pradesh. So they expanded their power, but they were opposed. They were stopped by Chalukyas of Gujarat in the west and Gahavadhawalis of western Uttar Pradesh. Prithviraj Chauhan was their most famous ruler. Yes. Among the Chamanas, Prithviraj Chauhan was the first most famous ruler. He defeated the Afghan ruler Mohammad Ghori in 1191, the Battle of Tarain, and but got defeated in 1192. Yes. So Prithviraj Chauhan was a famous ruler and he defeated the Afghan ruler Mohammad Ghori in First Battle of Tarain, that is 1191. And he was defeated in second battle, that is 1192. So students, this was about the western wealth of India and how the warfare was used in the, it was stored in the temples and kept reserved for the warriors. Students, so this we have studied about the second chapter, how rulers came and different rulers emerged in different parts of India and how they were ruling and they faced the invasions from the foreign tribes also, and protected India. So next about the kingdom of the south, we will be studying in the next class.